Okay. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. My name is Gabriela Zavala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And today we're going to be talking about the worst sin. So, inshallah, before I get started, I just wanted to share a short dua that you may have heard before and a lot of people will state before starting anything in their gatherings. So, inshallah, bismillah. And it reads, glory is to you, O Allah, and all praise is to you. I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship but you. I seek your forgiveness and repent to you. Ameen. So, alhamdulillah, we'll get started with the worst sin. And I just wanted to first just mention that for the past 2 months, Islam in Spanish has been covering the 7 conditions of the Shahada. And if you want to go back and look at those things, I believe they're on YouTube and possibly on their Facebook. So what is the Shahada? And I wanted to start off with this because it has to do with our talk today in regards to shirk, the worst sin. So what is the Shahada? The Shahada is your testimony of faith, or when one comes into Islam or accepts Islam, this is the statement that one will make. And I'll read it in the Arabic and then I'll translate it into English. So, it says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. And that will translate to, I testify that there is no God but Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is his messenger of Allah. So why is this important today? It is important because today we're going to be focusing on the first half of the Shahada, which is I testify that there is no God but Allah. And so by saying that, you're saying that it is the opposite of shirk. Okay, so what is shirk? And the opposite of shirk would be, the statement would be negating or denying shirk. So what is shirk? Shirk is when, one, you associate partners with Allah. Two, when you worship something or someone other than Allah. And three, when you rely on something other than Allah. So we're going to take it step by step. And I'm going to cover the first one, which is associating partners with Allah. So there is a statement that Abu Huraira reported, and it is, the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, Allah Almighty said, verily I am free of the idolatry of any partners. Whoever performs a deed in which he associates another with me, I will abandon him to his partners. So this is very clear. Allah is making it very clear to us that when you're associating anybody to him, he will abandon you to that partner, right? And that could be anything. It could be an actual idol or another deity, or it could also be something like worldly or in this dunya of this world, like something like money, right? And that's just a small example. So the first thing that comes to mind that many of you are probably familiar with being convert or looking into Islam is the Trinity. So what is the Trinity? It is what the Christians believe and they call, it's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so by making this statement, they're placing the Son and the Holy Spirit to a level where Allah or God, right, the Father, is. And this is a big, big mistake that is done in the religion, in Christianity in particular. And going back to the Shahada is, you're testifying that there is no other God but God, right? There is nothing that compares to him, and so we do not place anything or anyone to his level, right? He is our creator. He's the one that created us. He gave us life, and he'll take that life away from us. And so there is a verse in the Quran that I wanted to share with you all that states, surely we have sent to everyone a nation of messengers saying, worship Allah, God, and avoid false gods. And so, and this is in chapter 16, verse 36. So when I read this, I do think of, like, obviously Christianity, non-Muslims, and other religions that will place other deities to God. But I also think of, there are some Muslims who will worship or pray to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the Prophet Muhammad. May the peace and blessings be upon him. And although we have a lot of love for the Prophet, and we are advised to follow his ways, he has been the best of all messengers that has been sent to us as an example. And we do practice, right, his ways. But this does not mean that we praise him. This does not mean that we're putting him at a level to Allah, because nobody is at a level to Allah. And so I just wanted to clarify that, because I know sometimes there can be some confusion when we hear the name of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may the peace and blessings be upon him, come up so often. So I want to make sure that is clear and there's no confusion on that. So so again, that was the first example, right? And that is not associating partners with Allah. Now, the second point that I mentioned was worshiping something or someone other than Allah. Now, the most common, or not, I'm not saying most common, because I don't know what background or where you guys are coming from, what religion or how you grew up. But personally, I come from a Catholic background. I grew up Catholic. My family, they're all practicing Catholics. And for us, like, we were always surrounded by different saints, and, you know, the Virgin Mary, you have Jesus Christ on the cross. And so growing up, you don't necessarily look at these things like an actual statue that you have at home, right? But that's what it is. It's literally something that you can go buy at the store, $12, $20, however much, right? And people are going and facing them, praying to them, asking them for things, instead of going directly, you could say, to the source, right? You go to Allah. So this is the most common practice that I would say, the example that I could give you for worshiping something or someone other than Allah. And that would be the Virgin Mary or different saints that are maybe currently in your homes or in your parents' homes, in your family members' homes. And I know that it can be hard to understand, because when I talk to my mom, she in her view, like, she's not doing anything wrong, right? She still has the fear for God. She's still a practicing person. She's a good person. She gives back. And so she feels that when she goes to the Virgin Mary, she's not doing anything wrong. But we have to understand that we worship only Allah. We pray to only Allah. We ask for forgiveness to only Allah. And when we do things, we do them for the sake of Allah. So I did want to stop here and also read a narration. And this is narrated by Abi bin Hatim, may Allah be pleased with him. And it states, I heard the Prophet, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, read this verse. They, the Jews and Christians, took their rabbis and their monks to be their lords besides Allah. And Messiah, son of Maryam, while they were commanded to worship none but one, Illa, God, or Allah. La ilaha illa huwa, none has the right to be worshipped but He. Praise and glory be to Him, far above is He, from having the partners they associate with Him. And this part you can find in chapter 9, verse 31. And it continues to, "So I said to him, may Allah be pleased with him, verily we did not worship them. To which he replied, they did not make haram what Allah made halal, so you then made it haram. And did they not make halal what Allah made haram, and you therefore made it halal? I said, yes, and he said, that is worshiping them." So in short, he's saying that by taking something that was clearly sent to you in the Quran and by the Messenger of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you took what was haram, prohibited, and you changed it, right? Something that we're not supposed to do or intake, and you changed it to better fit your lifestyle. And so that was worshiping them, a type of worshiping them, and so advised against it and considered as shirk. Now, and again, that was worshiping something or someone other than Allah. Now, the third point is relying on something other than Allah. This one, I feel like the best example I could give would be anything that has to do with like charms, superstitions. This is you relying on something other than Allah, right? Because you believe that by carrying this rabbit's foot, it's going to bring you good luck, or it's going to change somehow your destiny, right? And by even by doing the smallest things, by knocking on wood, right, you're psychologically already committing shirk, because you may not think of it as a big deal, but if you're sitting there and something happens and you do not knock on wood, and you feel like you can't walk away without knocking on that piece of wood, instead of just leaving it up to Allah, that is you committing shirk. Because you shouldn't feel that way. You should be able to rely on Allah. You should be able to leave, and if something is bothering you, if you're going through a calamity, if you're having an issue, then you should pray to Allah. You should ask Him for guidance. You should ask Him to make whatever it is that you're wanting to happen, or to prevent something. And you should only rely on Him to make these things happen. And so something as small as knocking on wood is shirk. Another example would be for any Latinas that are watching, if any of your moms or your aunts, you know, your tías, if you put your purse on the floor, that is a big no-no, right? You're not allowed to do that, because then your money will go away, right? And so that's also a type of like superstition and shirk. And they'll even like run. As soon as you put your purse on, they'll run to you, pick it up, and put it on the table, right? And these type of things, they're silly, because they're being done, one, without knowing where that comes from. Two, you're relying on doing something as simple as that to change your faith. And three, you should be relying on Allah. He's the only one that could make things happen for us, that could change our faith, and also... once again, He's the one that gives us life, and He'll take the life away from us. Okay? He'll remove us from this dunya, from this world. And so, once again, that was relying on something other than Allah. Okay? So, those are the three that I wanted to cover with you about in regards to shirk. We can go very, very deep into it. There are many books, many videos about it, but shirk is essentially associating partners with Allah, when you worship something or someone other than Allah, and when you rely on something other than Allah. Now, the last example is is a type of like major shirk, and it is called riya. And what is riya? Riya is showing off. So when we do things, or when you do things, you want to do things solely for Allah. You want to do it to please Him. You want to do it for His pleasure. And that is with anything. With anything that you do, you want to make the intention first and then go and do the act. So for example, if you wanted to give charity, then you'll make your intention, you'll purify it, ask Him to purify your intention, and then, you know, bismillah, do it only for Him, and inshallah, just keep Him in mind at all times. So being God conscious, having that taqwa. So here, I also have another example that I wanted to share with you all. Now this states, when the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, states clearly that this action is minor shirk, such as in Al-Musnad, where it is narrated that Mahmud ibn Labid said, the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, said, the thing that I fear most for you is minor shirk. They said, O Messenger of Allah, what is minor shirk? He said, showing off, for Allah will say, on the day when people are recompensed for their actions, go to those for whom you are showing off with your deeds in the world and see what reward you find with them. So Allah's being pretty straight up, I guess you could say right here, right? Like you decided, you made a choice to do things to gain reward with others. So when you gave that charity, you did it to almost like boost yourself up because people would see you as a charitable person. Let's say like when you did anything, like even knowledge, even when you go and you gain knowledge and it's for the wrong reasons, again, for showing off how much knowledge you have and you have this pride, then Allah will question you for that. You did it for the wrong reasons. You did not do it to get close to Allah, which should be our main goal. When we gain knowledge, we want to do it for Allah, to get closer to Him, to allow our love for Him to grow. And also to be able to teach it to others, because ultimately you'll be spreading Islam, you'll be spreading the message, and that's really what you want to do it for, solely for Allah. So very important, that is an example of minor shirk, and there are other examples that we could give, but this would be like the gist of it. And before I stop, I just want to also remind you all that it is very important to seek knowledge. When you go and you seek knowledge, you do it again, you make your intention, you ask Allah to make it purely for Him, to purify it, and the more you know about Islam, the more you know about your religion, the more confident you'll feel, the more you'll be able to help others, teach others. But ultimately, it the most important to me is that Allah will bring you closer to Him and you'll love Him more and more each day. Yes, definitely my advice is to purify your intentions and try to avoid doing these things, because this is a major sin, and many say unforgivable sin. But if you are thinking about taking your shahada, once you take your shahada, Allah will forgive you for all those things that you did not know of in the past, or those sins you may have committed in the past, and you are, in a sense, wiped clean. It's a fresh start for you. And so if you're thinking about it, this is something that may have scared you. I'm not here to scare anybody, but it is important that we keep these things in the back of our heads and make sure that what we do is purely for Allah, that there are no partners to Him. We don't worship anybody but Him or anyone but Him. And anything and everything that you do is for the love of Allah. And inshallah, if I have made any mistakes, and may Allah forgive me for my mistakes, for my shortcomings. But that's it. If anybody has any questions. Okay. Go ahead.
So yeah, growing up in the West, you know, and in America, you know, in our culture, in movies, and in whatever, you know, also has to do with our culture. There's a lot of ideas about God, about the Creator, and you know, basically these notions of, you know, this is these are just like socially acceptable. So how do we go from changing these misconceptions and ideas of what we think of God, to basically, you know, what Islam teaches us about Allah and how we should rely upon Him solely? Because if I explain, like, you know, this to like my family or someone, and I say, hey, you guys should be careful with, you know, fortune telling and, you know, knocking on wood and, you know, all these things, are gonna think, oh, it's not a big deal. Mm-hmm. Right, we grew up, you know, doing these things. We grew up, you know, horoscopes, and you know, I think even Loteria has maybe some background stuff to it. I'm not sure, mm-hmm. but basically, it's things that are just kind of acceptable, like you said. Mm-hmm. People don't see them as a big deal. Mm-hmm. So how do we go from that and transition to understanding, you know, how we are supposed to, you know, worship Allah and our relationship to Him and His relationship towards us?
So I think for starters, you want to focus on, I think, the biggest issue, which is them going and worshiping statues or worshiping other than Allah, and trying to get them to understand what they're doing, right? Because a lot of the times, like you said, we're already used to doing this. You were used to, let's say, for example, just going to the Virgin Mary, right? I've been taught since I was little that I pray to the Virgin Mary, and then there's an understanding where God will hear it and hear my prayer, right? But just allowing them to understand that they've been like misguided, right? Like Shaitan, the devil, has made this, misguided them to the point where they're going to something else other than God, and getting them to understand that he's the creator. He's the only one that's going to be able to solve your issues or make these things happen. And with our families, like if you are like a convert and your families have not accepted Islam, we have to take baby steps with them. And so getting them to understand this part would be, I feel, the most important. And then working on the smaller things little by little. Because if I just go and I tell my mom to stop doing all these other things, she might start thinking about the wrong things, right? She's going to be focusing on this and that and, oh, let me not do this or whatever. But the most important is, I feel like, start with that. And then work your way down in getting them to understand that we shouldn't rely on these little habits, because that's what they are. They're just habits. And then inshallah, little by little, they'll get a better understanding of where you're coming from, because we don't want to confuse them, right? We want them to on their own, like, come to this realization, and on their own they'll start having these thoughts and questions come up. So, inshallah, I hope that helped. Anything else? Walaikum salam. The Did I convert to Islam? Yes, I did. Alhamdulillah.
Please tell us your experience. This is outside of the subject matter, but sisters and sisters just requesting some information. Please tell us your experience of your own Islamic household. Basically, do you have a family, meaning husband and children?
Mm-hmm.
How has Islam benefited your family life?
Okay, so after Islam, right? Alhamdulillah, I mean, Islam has benefited me in many, many ways. It has changed me personally in many ways. The starters just with patience. Patience is a big thing. I was very like a lost individual, very angry. I didn't have any guidance, and Islam brought that for me, because Islam ultimately it teaches us how to live, how to get through this world, how to get through the dunya, this world, and what to avoid, what is bad for us. It tells us what is good for us, and it also gave me something to look forward to, right? Because ultimately we all want to go to Jannah, to heaven, to paradise. And so the way it has affected me in my household, for starters, I became Muslim, and four years into it, I met my husband, and doing charity work. And so without Islam, I would not have my husband or my family that I have now. And two, my husband and I both are on the same path where we're seeking knowledge, and the most important thing to us is getting closer to Allah and having that understanding that everything that we do is for the pleasure of Allah. And so it allows our household to work a lot smoother. We agree on a lot of things, how things are done, why things are done. And this is how Islam has affected me personally in the home. It just, I feel, brings a lot of peace to me. It answers a lot of questions that I have had in the past. And it's just overall, like, I don't know in what way Islam has not affected me or my family in my household, because I do things for the sake of Allah, and I continue to pray that He keeps that in my heart, that I'm able to purify my intentions every day, and that He keeps me on the straight path, because He could easily remove that from us. He could easily remove everything that I have in my life. And so I'm just grateful for having Islam. It really does affect every single part of one's lifestyle and home and family. So. Okay, cool. Alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khair for listening to me, and inshallah, it was a benefit to you all. And once again, I ask Allah to forgive me if I've said anything that was wrong. Thank you. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.